Glory, amen. Well, thanks to God. We thank God, amen, for blessing us to be able to come out once again into the house of God. Amen. We see, amen, Kyron, amen, have made it home. Amen. Well, we give God praise. Amen. He's still in the land of the living. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. Amen. Be praying for Deacon Turner and Sister Turner. Amen. To my understanding, both of them are sick. Amen. I believe Mother Gillum may be still sick. Amen. So keep them in your prayer, saints of God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. And the Lord wants to speak to our hearts on this evening. Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Yes, Lord. Heaven, could you please say amen.
Amen.
Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things said he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars.
Yes.
And has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love.
Yes.
Remember therefore from which thou hast fallen, and repent, and do the first works.
Yes.
Or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches. To him that overcome, what I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God.
Oh, yes.
Now look at your neighbors. The neighbor.
The
church.
The church.
That left. His first love.
His first love.
Amen. That's what I want to speak to you about on today. Last Wednesday, we began to speak about Jesus introducing himself to the church. Mm-hmm. Amen. And Jesus began to reveal who he was to the church. Mm-hmm. But saints of God, this week we're going to deal with Jesus writing a message to the church. Because we know, saints of God, that Jesus is the head of the church.
Okay.
And when we get marching orders, we get marching orders from Jesus. We come into the house of God to hear what Jesus has to say through the Holy Ghost. Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yeah.
But Jesus wrote to the church here in Ephesus in chapter 2. Now, I want you to understand that these seven letters that we're getting ready to deal with, saints of God, because we're going to be on this, amen, for a while. These seven letters that Jesus wrote to the seven churches. It was seven main churches that he wrote at this time that was in Asia. And these seven letters, saints of God, are not just for the churches back then, but they are also for the modern day church.
Yes.
Now, saints of God, we can gauge ourselves based on these seven letters. If we really want to see what we are, we can gauge ourselves based on these seven letters. Jesus wrote these seven churches, amen,
yes,
to let them know that he knew what was going on inside of every church, because he is the head of the church. He built the church. We dealt with that Jesus, he is the head of the church. Not only is he the head of the church, but he is the foundation of the church. He is the architect of the church. He is the chief cornerstone. Do you hear me, saints of God? So when we begin to deal with Jesus, we begin to understand that Jesus is the head of the church. And he began here to write to the church. Now, who is the church? Because, saints of God, we have to get our identity back in the house of God. Because when we look in the land today, the church is not being what God meant for it to be.
Yes.
Because when we look at the church, sometimes we can't tell no different from the church than the world.
Yes.
But I believe that God is raising up vessels that's going to get ready to make sure that the church is prepared for the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, since God, when we deal with the church, church means called out ones. Jesus was not writing to the world. He was writing to the church. He was writing to the called out ones. When we say that we are the church, we are saying that we are the called out ones. What do I mean by called out ones? Called out ones mean called out of darkness and called into the marvelous light. We are called out of the world and we are called unto Jesus. We cannot say that we are the church and say to God we are still living in a sinful life in the world. He was right to the church, to the called out ones. If we are still in, guess what? We are not the church. If we're still in the club, guess what? We are not the church. If we're still at the house party with everybody else, guess what? We are not the church. If we're still in the bed with somebody who ain't our wife, who ain't our husband, guess what? We are not the church. Because the church is the called out ones. You got to be called out of darkness and called into the marvelous light. And saints of God, he said, I'm talking to the church. Who is the church? The church is the light of the world. Because Jesus said, you are the light of the world.
Yeah.
But saints of God, when we say that we are the church, we are saying that we are the light of the world. Jesus said that a city that is set on top of a hill cannot be hid. And we admit about this, and back in this time, whenever you seen a city built on top of the hill, they had torches in the window. And when you was walking in the wilderness, the way that you knew your way to the city was that you would see lights in the window.
Amen.
But you would see the city sitting on top of a hill. Well, the church is supposed to be a city that's sitting on top of a hill. Well, then when people come out of darkness, they can see what direction they're supposed to go.
Yeah.
He was writing to the church. The church is the light of the world, which means that when people who are in darkness, they're supposed to be able to know how to come out of darkness by watching you.
Yeah.
Paul said that we are living in epistles read by all men. That when people see you, they should be able to read your life.
Amen.
They should be able to see you and read about Jesus. They should be able to read you and see holiness. Come on, saints of God. Because when we say that we are the church, we are saying that we are living in epistles that's read by all men. And people on your job is reading you. People in your community is reading you.
Yeah.
People in your church is reading you. Why? Because you are living in epistles. How do we live? Do we live holy? Do we say one thing and do something else? Do you even sense God? Because we are living in epistles. And we don't want nobody to read us the wrong way.
Come on.
He's speaking to the church. He's speaking to the salt of the earth. And we know that salt always brings flavor to food. But he says salt that loses its flavor ain't good for nothing but to be walked on and make paths for other people to walk on. But we are the salt of the earth, which means that we have some flavor.
Oh, yes.
That we bring season to the situation.
Yes.
We bring season to a dead situation. He said, you are the salt of the earth. He said, you are peculiar people.
Oh, yes.
Saints of God, when we say that we are the church, we are saying that we are a peculiar people. Peculiar means different. Saints of God, we got so many people in the church that's trying to be like the world.
Yes.
We got so many people in the church who trying to dress like the world and trying to do things like the world.
Wow.
But we are peculiar people. You're supposed to be different.
Oh, yes.
You don't supposed to try to act like the world. The world's supposed to look at you and say, I want what they got. Do you even say something? But when we look in the church, we see the church trying to be like the world. The church trying to be like Beyonce. The church trying to be like Jay-Z. Come on, saints of God. We're trying to be like the world. We're trying to bring the world into the church. We're trying to talk like the world and act like the world. And you want to how come the world don't want Jesus? Because when the world see you, they see the world. They don't see the church. Saints of God, we have to realize who we are. We got to get our identity back, saints of God. We cannot lose our identity in a world who's telling the church what they're supposed to do. How are you going to tell the church what to do?
My God.
And you the world. How a heathen don't tell a man or woman of God what they're supposed to do?
Yes.
But saints of God, we got to be careful that we don't lose our identity. Because the church is a peculiar people, which means that we are different. You're supposed to be different. If you're serving Jesus, guess what? You're supposed to be different.
Yeah.
If you say that you're holy, you're supposed to be different. You're supposed to talk different. You're supposed to act different.
Yeah.
You didn't even say to God. But he was talking to the church. He was speaking to the peculiar ones.
Yes, Lord.
And saints of God, we cannot lose our identity as a church. We got to get back to being the church. Back in the day, people knew the church. They said they were them sanctified people. They knew who the church was. They knew that it was so different. They know that you didn't do the same thing they was doing and living the same way they was living. You hear the sense, God? There's Revelation chapter 2. We got to get back to being the church. We cannot lose our identity. But he was right to the church. Church, we are lively stones. Jesus is the chief cornerstone. Yeah. But the church, we're lively stones. We're not dead, we're lively. We're lively with the joy of God. And lively with the peace of God. And lively with the power of God. And lively with the fire of God. Yeah. You hear me, saints, God? Yeah. We got to get back to being the church. When Jesus wrote this letter here to the church of Ephesus, he was not writing the world, but he was writing the church.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my God. Because he is the head of the church. He is the captain of your salvation. He is the author and finisher of your faith.
Yeah.
And saints of God, the church needs to give an ear to what Jesus is saying to the church. He wants the church, the peculiar ones, the lively stones. We are the bride of Christ because Jesus is coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. We are the body of Christ. Do you even sense God?
Yeah.
We are a holy nation.
Holy
means like no other. When you say that you're holy, that don't mean that you got a dress on with holes in it. No, holy means like no other, which means I'm like no other.
Yeah.
I talk like no other. I act like no other. I walk like no other.
Yeah.
You hear me, saints, God? When everybody going to the club, all on my face before God, crying out to God, give me the sense, God, because we're holy, we like no other. We love our enemies when they can't save us. Why? Because I'm holy. Do you hear me, saints of God? You got to understand who the church is. That we are peculiar people. That we are a holy nation. Oh, my God. That we are the body of Christ. That we are living stones. Fiery stones. Yes, Lord. We are peculiar people. We are a holy nation. We are a royal priesthood. Jesus said, you are a royal priesthood. You got to understand who the church is. So here in Revelation chapter 2, verse 1, Jesus is writing to the church. To the church of Ephesus. He said to the angel of the church of Ephesus. Look at verse 1. Unto the angel of what?
Of the church
of Ephesus. Now, who are we talking about? He ain't talking about supernatural beings. He ain't talking about an angel that's in heaven with God. Why would God need a man to write a letter to an angel? He's not speaking about angels in heaven. When you look the word angel, in Greek it means messenger. He's speaking about the messenger of their church. He's speaking about the leader, the pastor of their church.
Yeah.
He said, listen, I'm writing a message to the messenger of their church. He's not talking about supernatural beings. Why would God have to write the angel? Why would God have to tell a man to write a letter to the angel? Angels do not lead the church. The Bible said that angels encamp around those who fear him, which means that angels protect the church. Angels, the Bible said that they excel in strength, hearkening unto the voice of God. When you read the seven letters here in the Revelation, out of seven of the church, Jesus told five of them, you need to repent. Well, why would Jesus tell an angel to repent? An angel don't have to repent. Do you hear me, saints of God? Why would he say, you need to repent? Guess what? Angels don't repent. Because when Satan disobeyed God, God cast them down to hell. They couldn't repent. Angels cannot repent. Because why? They was there in the glory of God. Satan was right there in the presence of God. And when they disobeyed God, God cast them down to hell. When Jesus came to die, he took on the seed of Abraham. He didn't take on the seed of an angel, which means he came to die for mankind.
Yeah.
He came to shed his blood for mankind. He didn't shed his blood for angels.
Oh, yes.
So when he woke the church, he wouldn't write angels. Why would God tell an angel, you need to repent?
Oh, yeah.
Some churches, God said, you're lukewarm. God said, you ain't hot or you ain't cold. God said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Why would God tell the angel that you lukewarm? An angel ain't lukewarm. You got holy angels and you got demons that used to be angels. Do you hear me, saints, God? Why would God have to tell the angel that you need to repent for being lukewarm? That don't make no sense. And if God want to say something to an angel, God just will tell the angel. He wouldn't tell a man to write a letter and give it to an angel. That sound dumb. Do you hear me, saints, God? When you read about these churches, God said, I know about the trials and tribulations that you've been through. Guess what? Angels don't go through trials and tribulations. They're right there in the presence of God.
Yeah.
There is no trials and tribulations for them to go through. So he said unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, he was not speaking about holy angels. He was speaking about pastors over their church.
Yes, yes.
Or apostles that was over their church. Or leaders that was over their church. He was speaking to the messengers that was over their church. Do you understand, Scott?
Yes.
He was speaking to the pastor. Can't nothing come in a church unless, first of all, they go through the pastor. If a message, God said, give it to the pastor. Let the pastor read the letter that I just wrote through you, Apostle John, and have the pastor to read it to the congregation. That's the order of God. Don't nothing come into the church unless it comes through the pastor. If a person come in and try to speak some kind of doctrine, guess what? The pastor had to okay it, or the pastor had to shut it down. Do you understand, God? So he said unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, I'm going to give you understanding. He was speaking to their pastor, because the pastor, oh my God, had the responsibility. When you look the word pastor up in the Greek, it means shepherd. It means one who feed, because they feed you the word of God.
Yes.
Shepherds mean one who tend to the flock. A shepherd is somebody who leads the flock into the direction that God is leading them.
Yes.
He even says, God, so the pastor is responsible for what's going on in the church. Now, saints of God, he's not responsible for people living wrong. He's responsible for what he get up and teach and what he allowed to go on inside the house of God.
Yeah.
So when God wrote to the angel of the church of Ephesus, he was writing to their pastor.
Oh, yes.
Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, he said, what? Write. These things said he that holded the seven stars in his right hand. I told you last Wednesday that the seven stars that John saw, he saw seven stars in Jesus' right hand. He said, I want you to write this, oh my God. He said, these things said he that holded the seven stars in his right hand. I told you the seven stars was the seven pastors that was over their church. Why did he call them stars? Because something about a star brings illumination at night, which means it brings light. Something about a leader or a pastor, he has to bring light in the church. Do you hear me say, God? I told you that we are the light of the world. So when he said the angel of their church, he said he did hold the seven stars in his right hand. I told you that those stars represent leaders, represented pastors, because a star brings illumination, and something else that a star do, it brings a gravitational pull. Which means pastors have the anointing to bring a gravitational pull to pull people into the presence of God. You hear me, saints of God? But he said, listen, tell them that our Jesus hold the seven stars in our right hand. Which means the right hand means power. He said, I hold these pastors in my power. That's what you got to understand, that the pastor is in Jesus' hand. He said, listen, I hold the seven stars in my right hand. The right hand represents power, and it represents direction. He said, listen, I hold those leaders in my power, and I'm the one that give them direction.
Yes.
Do you hear me, saints of God? He's speaking about these seven leaders. He said, I hold the seven stars in my right hand. Mm-hmm. He said, I walk in the midst of the golden lampstands. We learned last Wednesday that he told John the seven lampstands or the seven candlesticks that you saw represent seven churches. Do you hear me, saints of God? When John saw him the first time, he was standing in the midst of the seven churches. But this time, he said, I saw Jesus walking in the midst of the church. Walk means live, to live in, which means that Jesus lives inside of the church. Do you believe it, saints of God? Every church should have Jesus Christ living inside of it. He said, I'm walking in the midst of the church. Walk means to walk about, which means Jesus is making his rounds in the church, which means that Jesus knows what's going on in the church. Saints of God, if it's really a church of Jesus, he will be walking about in the church. Walk means moving, which means he said, I'm moving in my church.
Yes.
He said, I'm there in the midst. If two or three are gathered together in my name, he said, I'm there in the midst. But Jesus said, he was walking. He said, I'm the one that walking in the church. He said, I'm moving in the church. I'm moving through the Holy Ghost. When you see people get healed, that's that Jesus walking through his church. When you see people get delivered, that's Jesus walking in his church. When you see people get saved, that's Jesus walking in the church. When you hear the word of God being spoken, that's Jesus walking in the church. He said, I am Jesus, and I walk in the midst of the church.
Oh, yes.
I see what's going on. Oh my God. And this is up to us as leaders. Let me tell you something. The Bible said that we're going to be judged with a street of judgment.
Yes.
That if you are called to preach the word and you called to be a leader, God said you're going to be judged with a street of judgment.
Yes.
Jesus, I want you to tell them that I see what's going on. He said, I know what's going on. He said, I know what you're doing behind closed doors. He said, I already see it. He
yes.
said, because I, Jesus, I walk in the midst of the church. Oh my God. He said, I see what's going on in the midst of the church. He said, I walk in the midst of the church.
Mm-hmm.
In the midst means in the middle of.
The middle.
Which means Jesus is among the church.
Yes.
Since God, you don't have to fear because Jesus is among the church. I'm talking about the Lamb of God is among the church. The leader of the valley is among the church. The bright and morning star is among the church. The Son of God is among the church. Your Savior and your Redeemer is among the church.
Yes.
He said, I'm in the midst
yes,
of the church.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible said, when two or three are gathered together in my name, in the name of Jesus, he said, what? I'm there in the midst. When we come together in the house of God in the name of Jesus, he said, I'm right there in the midst.
Yes.
He literally says, yeah, when we come and call on Jesus, he said, I'm there in the midst. I don't care what you're going through. He said, I'm there in the midst. When you listen to my love coming into the house of God, when David
yes.
said, I was glad when they said it to me, let us go into the house of God. Why?
Yes.
Because when you come into the house of God, Jesus is going to be right there in the midst.
Yes.
And says about you need Jesus right there in the midst of your problem, right in the midst of your home, right in the midst of your heart. He said, I'm there in the midst.
Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, my God.
Thank you, Jesus.
He said, I'll walk in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Talking about the church. Look at verse 2. What did he say?
I know your works.
He said, I know your works. He's talking to the church now. When the pastor read the letter, he said, Jesus said, I know your works. He said, listen, I know your actions and your deeds.
Oh, yeah.
He said, I know what's going on in the church. He said, don't think that I don't know what's going on. He said, but I know your works. Now I know you got people tomorrow saying, well, we save by grace through faith, and once saved, always saved. And let me go ahead and deal with this right now. Even once saved, always saved, and you can't lose your salvation. And once you get saved, it's over with. You can do what you want to do and live the way that you want to live. And we got these preachers now telling people you don't have to repent when you do wrong. If you disobey God, all your sins are forgiven, both past, present, and future. And you don't have to ask God for forgiveness. Well, that ain't nothing but a lie. Because here in the Revelation, when you read Revelation, when you read the seven churches that Jesus wrote to, out of seven of them, five of them, he told you better repent.
Yes.
Well, if you couldn't lose your salvation, why would you tell me to repent?
Yes.
If I'm once saved, always saved, but I can't lose my salvation, why tell me to repent? If I don't have to ask God for forgiveness when I sin against God, why would he tell me to repent?
Yes,
that throw that whole theory out the door. And most people who said that they use Paul.
Mm-hmm.
I only preach from Paul. When you preach, you're supposed to preach the whole counsel of God.
Yes.
You don't give one person say, I only preach from this person. But when people are trying to prove their point, they'll preach from one person. But some people say, I just preach from Paul because Paul spoke about grace.
Mm-hmm.
But when you read 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul told the Corinthians church, he said, I'm going to come back to y'all the third time.
Yes.
He said, when I come back this time, he said, I'm going to be sorrowful because there's many of you who have been in uncleanness and fornication. He said, you have not what? You have not repented.
Yes.
The man that was in the Corinthian church was committing sexual acts with his father's wife, his stepmom. Paul said, and y'all bossing about this?
Mm-hmm.
He said, put that man out of the church. If once saved, always saved, why would Paul say, put the man out of the church?
Mm-hmm.
He said, look, that the legends the whole lot. And then when you read 2 Corinthians, the man repented. And God and Paul said, since he repented, he said, bring the man back in.
Yes.
Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yes.
So if we was once saved, always saved, why would Paul tell the people, you need to repent when I get ready to come back? If he was once saved, always saved, how come in Revelation, Jesus told five other churches, you need to repent? So they throw their theory out the door.
Oh, yeah.
Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yeah.
You got people who have snuck into the church and they bring in false teaching and false doctrines in. But God said, I will give them pastors after my own heart.
Who
will feed them with knowledge.
Yeah.
Do you hear me, saints of God? Because when God gives you a shepherd, he makes sure that you don't eat stuff that's poison.
Come on. Yes, Lord.
That's what come David said, the Lord is my shepherd. And he lead me to green pastures. Which means he don't let me eat no poison weeds. Because sheep don't know no different. They'll eat poison weeds and die. But the shepherd lead them to green pastures so they can eat the right grass. Do you understand, Scott? Yeah. But he said, I know your works. Don't tell me words don't mean anything. Because if they did, Jesus then would have said, I know your actions and I know your deeds. He said, I'm looking at your words. No, you don't do works to be saved. You do good works because you are saved. Do you hear me say to God?
Oh, yeah.
He said, but I know your words.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I know what you're doing. Oh my God. He said, I know your work. He said, I'm aware of what's going on.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus is aware of what's going on in his church. Say, so God, let me take some. We as leaders, we ain't getting away with nothing. We think we get away with something. I'm talking about leaders who play with God's people. You robbing God's people. You slipping and tipping. You doing stuff. But Jesus will tell them, I know your works. He said, I know what you're doing.
Yeah.
He even says,
yeah.
He said, I'm a liar. Because I walk in the midst of my church. He said, I'm walking around in my church.
Yeah.
Among my people. He said, I'm a liar. He said, I know your works.
Oh, yes.
I'm aware. I consider. Oh my God. No means to consider. He said, I'm considering what you're doing. No means to proceed. Which means I see what you're doing and I see what you're saying. Says to God, Jesus, I see what you're doing, leaders. And he said, I see what you're saying. What you're preaching to my people, I got angels in here. God got angels in here right now, everything I'm saying. Because in that day, we have to give an account for everything we spoke to God's
yes.
people. Every idle word, we got to give account for it. Do you hear me say to God? He said, I know what you're doing, and I see what you're saying. He said, I know what you're saying. He said, I know what you're preaching. See, so we have gotten away from God. We ain't leading people to the presence of God anymore. We lead people to dead presidents and cars and clothes. Do you hear me say to God? We got saints who don't even want to come to church because they can't pull up in the same car that somebody pull up in you. Why? Because you got a leader that's preaching a false gospel. It's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not about the death, burial, and resurrection. It's not about the middle of the valley and the body known as God. It's not about Jesus. It's not about the Son of God. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. It's not about the Good Shepherd. It's not about the true God. It's not about Jesus. It's not about him that was one of our angels, who was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. It's not about the comfort of our salvation and the often finish of our faith. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. What you're saying.
Yeah.
He said, I perceive. He said, I know your works. Oh my God, I'm aware of what's being spoken in my house. But Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and a stranger that will not follow. You know when you are Jesus' sheep.
Oh yes.
When a person preaches something, you say, that is not right. That is not in the word of God.
Come on.
Let me excuse myself from here right now. Because I know Jesus' voice. Because if it's Jesus' voice, he's going to pull me close to him. Come on, saints of God. If it's the word of God, it's going to pull you close to Jesus. If it's the word of God, it's going to lift up Jesus. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me.
Yeah.
Jesus just lift me up. We're not lifting up no houses, lifting up no cars, lifting up what we were, lifting up what we got, what house we live in. We
yeah.
come to lift up Jesus. But he's right to the churches. And right now, saints of God, God is getting the churches back ready. See, saints of God, you don't keep on hearing messages like this over and over again. I told my wife, it been some months ago last year, and I said, listen, I said, you're going to keep on hearing messages like this over and over again because God is shaking some leaders. And God said, listen, stop preaching what you're preaching and get back to the gospel because God is trying to get the church ready. And that's what I told you earlier, who the church was. We can't lose our identity. We got to stay the call out on us. We got to stay the light of the world. Jesus come back for a church without spot or wrinkle. Be with me, saints, God. All he that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, that we are royal priesthood, that we are a holy nation. We are a chosen nation. We are the body of Christ. We are the bride of Christ. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. He said, I'm coming back for a church.
Oh, yes.
Well, I spot a wrinkle. And I told you a couple of witnesses ago that Jesus is only coming back for the church. If you ain't the church, you're going to be left behind. If you have not accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I feel so sorry for you because you're going to be left behind. But Jesus said, listen, I know your works. and thy labor and your patience. This church had, they labored for him. Listen to this now. Look at verse 2. He said, I know your patience. He said, you're very patient. He said, how thou cannot bear them that are evil, evil people that came in the congregation. Listen, if it was men of God who said they were serving God and they was evil, they got rebuked in this church. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and they are not. You can slip in on this church. They had great discernment. When you came to the door to my son, I'm Apostle Willie, they sat there and they watched you. They watched what you say and what you preach. Be with me, says God. And he said, listen, you found out certain people who were saying they was apostles. He said, you found them out to be liars.
Oh, God.
He said, listen, and you have more. Look at verse 3. You have that patience. He said, you don't have patience for my great name's sake. He said, you have labor for my name. He said, you have not what? You have not fainted. Look at verse 4. Nevertheless, I have this against you. Because you have what?
Left your first love.
He said, you left your first love. He said, y'all got patience. He said, y'all labor for my name. He said, the church, he said, y'all very discerning. You can tell when something is not of God. He said, you have not fainted. You still believe in my word. He said, but I got something against you. He said, because you left your first love,
yes.
Which means left means abandoned. He said, you abandoned your first love. First means chief, which means most important. He said, y'all are left away from loving on me.
My God.
He said, y'all are left from loving Jesus. He said, y'all got all these works, but yet you don't love me. Saints of God, sometimes we can be doing things for, we can be doing things that God told us, but we can be doing it without a love for God.
Oh, God.
I'm going to talk to us tonight, saints of God. I got 20 some more minutes, but this is the part I wanted to get to, because I told you that this church left their first love. He said, y'all don't left y'all first love. He said, y'all don't even love me anymore. He said, y'all just going through emotions. He said, y'all meet up, but y'all ain't meeting up for me. He said, y'all do things, but y'all ain't doing it for me. Do you hear me, saints of God? Love means to have goodwill towards somebody.
Oh, yes.
To have preference. He said, y'all don't even prefer me anymore. Oh, we got some churches right now that we don't even prefer Jesus anymore. We come into the house of God, we don't even prefer him. We don't even call out to him. When we come into the house of God, it's not for Jesus. I'm coming into the house of God so I can learn 7 steps how to get more money.
My God. Jesus.
Come on, saints of God. Give me 7 steps, Rev, of how to live a successful life. Give me 7 steps, real, how to sow, give more money. But I have not come to hear anything about Jesus, the Son of the living God. He said, you don't left me. How many in the church, we have left Jesus. We still coming into the building, but we have left Jesus. In our heart, we backslid a long time ago. We have left away from Jesus. He said, you left your first love. The most important person of the church is Jesus. He said, you have left your first love. God wants us to love him. He wants us to be fond of him. He wants us to be affectionate towards him. But we can see in the house of God that when we come into the house, there is no affection for Jesus.
Oh my God.
We don't even lift our hands in his presence because we don't left our first love. We don't even acknowledge him and barely call on his name. You know why? Because we have left our first love. And I don't know what drew you away from Jesus and what stopped you from loving Jesus. But Jesus said, I want you to get ready to get back before my presence.
Yeah.
Did you hear me say, God? He said, you left your first love. Left with me. There is no fellowship. How do you know when you left your first love? Because there is no fellowship in the natural. How do you know when a marriage have lost its fire and love? Because there is no fellowship.
Yes.
There is no communion. The husband and wife don't communicate with each other. The husband and wife don't fellowship with each other.
Yes.
You say, how do I know if I don't left Jesus, if I have left my first love? We love him because what? He first loved us. The reason why we love Jesus is not being, we love him because why? He first loved us. The Bible said, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. When you were still in your mess, Jesus died for you. Do you hear me, saints God?
Yes.
We love Jesus because he first loved us. Remember when you first came to God? Remember when you first got filled with the Holy Spirit? Remember when you first felt God's presence come over you and you felt the power of God. Remember God filled you with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues and you was laid out in the floor and they had to carry you to the car. Remember you were speaking in tongues all the way home. You felt the love of Jesus. You was happy to come into the house of God. You was happy to hear the word of God. You was happy to go pray and spend some time with God. But somewhere along the line, you lost your fervency for Jesus. You lost your love for Jesus. Now you don't even want to hear the word. Now you don't even want to pick up the word. Now you don't even want to pray. When prayer come up to you, you find something else to do. You know why? Because you have left your first love.
Jesus.
You left Jesus, the one that was wounded for your transgressions and bruised for your iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace is upon him, and by his strength we are here. We left away from Jesus. He said that you done left your first love. Oh my God. He said you got all these things. He said you got patience. He said, listen, you labored for my name. You very discerning. But 1 Corinthians 13th chapter, I believe, 12th or 13th chapter. Because if we don't love God, everything that we do is in vain.
Oh, yes.
Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 through 3. Paul said, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all the mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I'm nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, it profit me nothing. It does not matter what we do, saints of God. The Bible says, whatever we do in word or deed, do it as unto the Lord. Everything that we do, we need to do it for our love for God. That don't mean that we don't love people now. Somebody hungry? We feed them because we love them. Do you hear me, saints of God? But ultimately, I'm feeding you and I'm doing it unto God. Do you hear me, saints of God? He said, the things that you are doing, Jesus said, you're not doing it for me. He said, you're just going through the motions. Don't you know, saints of God, we can't be obeying God's word, but not really loving him, and we can be going through the motions. Don't you know we can't be obeying God's word and we can have a cold heart toward Jesus and really don't love Jesus? Don't you know that we can be singing on a choir, singing on a praise team, but really don't love Jesus? Don't you know that we can be teaching and preaching and it really still don't love Jesus? Just because you're teaching and preaching don't mean that you love Jesus. Just because you give in the house of God don't mean that you love Jesus. Do you hear me, saints of God? Because everything that we do, we need to do it unto Jesus. I'm doing it because I love you, Jesus. I'm doing it because you first loved me. I'm doing it because you shed your blood for me. I'm doing it, do you even say, God, for the Son of God. Say, God, we got to take inventory. We got to check our heart. I began to weep as I went over this word because God began to let me hear some things. And I began to weep. And God said, many have left away from me. They don't love me anymore. He said they doing things, but they're not doing it for the love of me. We sing it, but we don't love Jesus. We sing, we come to the house of God to sing, and we didn't even listen to the word that we sing it. Why? Because to us, it's a performance. Now we have turned to a performance. The choir to sing my favorite song. You didn't come for Jesus, baby. You came for your favorite song. You know what it says, God? We got to be truth in the house of God. We sing it to the person that we don't even love. We sing it to Jesus, and we don't even have no relationship with. We sing it to Jesus, and we only sing to him on Sunday, but Monday through Saturday, we don't say anything to Jesus. We don't have no relationship with him. Come on, say to God. He said, Jesus, right in the church. He said, you sing it to me, but you don't love me. He said, you preach it and you teach it, but you don't love it. The pastor's preaching, but that don't mean that the pastor loves Jesus. The prophet gave you a prophetic word, but that don't mean that the prophet loves Jesus. You hear me, say to God? Because sometimes we can be doing things for the wrong reason.
Yes, Lord.
We can be giving money into the house of God, but don't really love Jesus. We can give it with a grudge. Here, Jesus. Here they go again to my offering time. And we throw it up in there in our heart. In our heart. The Bible says God loves a cheerful giver. He sees what we give. The Bible said that a woman was coming up to the temple. Came in the temple. The Bible said Jesus was sitting by the treasury when she came in. And when she came in, It was a rich man came in and gave a whole lot of money. And a poor woman came in and gave just a little bit. And he said, I tell you, that poor woman gave more than that rich man. Why? Because she gave all she had. She gave, she made a sacrifice for Jesus. You know what I'm saying? Jesus is standing by the treasury. When we give, angels are writing down our attitude. God see our heart when we give. The Bible says don't give grudgingly or of necessity. Yeah. But when you give from a heart of love for Jesus. We doing things in the house of God, but we don't love God. Come on, saints of God.
Yes.
Just because we write books about Jesus, don't mean that we love Jesus.
Yes.
Just because you see people cut CDs about Jesus and sing about Jesus, don't mean that they love Jesus. Because if you don't got no relationship with Jesus, you're not spending no time with Jesus, you don't obey the words of Jesus, guess what? You don't love him. Why? He said, if you love me, keep my word.
Keep my word.
Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do what I say? And see, now the church really don't want to hear preaching like this. Because this means that we have to examine our heart.
Yes.
This means that we got to get back on the altar and ask God, God, save me all over again.
Yes.
God, wash me all over again.
Yes.
God, purify me all over again. Our titles is stopping us from getting on the altar.
Come on. Yes, Lord.
The office that we walk in is stopping us from getting on the altar. But when I was going over this word in the prayer room, I began to weep. I said, Lord, please forgive me. Because sometimes you can be having idols before God and don't even know me. You can be preaching and don't even love him. You can be preaching just for entertainment, but not preaching for Jesus. You can be prophesying, and you can be prophesying correct, but you can be prophesying not for the love of Jesus, but so that people can say, look at that prophet, or so that you can get somebody to give some money. Are we doing it for Jesus? Oh, saints of God, the way that we dress when we come into the house of God, I know some of you will get mad at me, but it's all right, because I got to do what God tells me to do. Oh, we come into the house of God, our blessings all out, our clothes are all tight, but we say we coming for Jesus. You ain't going up a line. You say you feel what the Holy Ghost wanted. When you look in the mirror before you leave home, and you look behind you, and you see the gold clothes are too tight, showing your print, showing your cleavage, and you say you're coming for Jesus, you ain't coming for Jesus, you're coming for a fashion show, you're coming for somebody to look at you, you're trying to get the attention of Jesus, but Jesus said you're doing it, but you ain't doing it for me. And on that day, we're going to be in some trouble, because the Lord say, you did all of that, but you didn't do it for me. You did it to become rich. You did it so you can have a great name. You did it so you can drive a nice car. He said, but you didn't do it for my glory. Saints of God, everything that we do, we have to do for the glory of God. Everything that we're doing, is it for the Lord? Casting out devils, but do you love Jesus? Laying hands on the sick, they're being healed, but do you love Jesus? Walking in miracles, but do you love Jesus? In that day, many will say to me, Lord, have we not cast out devils in your name? Spoke, have we not cast out devils in your name and did many miracles in your name? He said, apart from me, I never knew you. Why would he say that? He said, because we had no relationship. You didn't do those things for me. You did it for yourself. And see, let me tell you something. Something God showed me. Just because God's power is moving in the house of God. Now, this isn't it. Some of you upset. Just because God's power is moving in the house of God don't mean that those people love Jesus. The way that you know a person love Jesus is they give their life to him completely and they follow his teachings.
Oh, yes.
Sometimes people casting out devils not for Jesus, but to be seen. It's a big show. Just because God gives you something when you pray and ask him for it, don't mean God is accepting your lifestyle.
Come on, sir.
God said, tell them I'm a generous God. So when he asked me for it, God said, I still give it to him. We come in the house of God, we testify. I asked God for a job, and God gave me a job. And I asked God for a car, and God gave me a car. And I asked God for a wife or a husband, and God gave it to him. Praise the Lord, saints of God. But God said, I gave it to him because I'm a generous God. God said, I let it rain on the righteous as well as the unrighteous.
Yeah.
We might get caught up in that sense of God. Because when you know that you don't got no relationship with Jesus, he gave you the job, but you know you don't got no relationship with him. He gave you the husband, but you know you don't got no relationship with him. He gave you whatever you asked for, but you know you don't got no relationship with him. He healed your body, and you know you don't got no relationship with him. You ain't did nothing that God told you to do. He said, I give because I'm generous. He said, I give because I'm love. God is love. He said, but just because I give it to you, don't mean that I agree with your lifestyle.
Oh, yes.
And you'll get in trouble. on the day of judgment. When you, but God, you did all this. And God said, yes, I did all that because I'm a generous God. And my word is true. If you call on the name of Jesus, you should cast out devils. You should lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. He already said that. Just because somebody cast out a devil don't mean that they love Jesus. Because he said, if you use my name, you'll cast the devil out. If you use my name, you'll heal the sick. If you use my name, you'll walk in miracles. Guess what? You give, go to church, give me 7 principles about how to get rich, Rev. Nothing wrong with speaking about money, but they can't be the message every time people come to the house of God. Okay, you sow, you give. Guess what? You get an increase. I'm giving because God, I need my business to pick off the ground. You give and God let your business pick off the ground. You say, God, I'm giving because I need a car. You give and God bless you with a car. Just because God bless you with it don't mean that God is pleased with your lifestyle and your relationship with him. God did it because God said, my word will not return to me void. And I'm not a man that I should lie. And I said in my word that he that sowed bountifully should reap bountifully. Yeah. So if you give a whole lot, God said you still gonna get back a whole lot, even if you ain't know what God say. But God said you give it not because you want me, but because you want the money, because you want the car, because you want the house. He said you're not doing it for the love of me. Let me show you idol worship. Get ready to come to a close. Let me show you idol worship. When the Lord showed me this, I told you I was weeping when I was going over this. Because the word come to us first. I began to weep. I said, God, forgive me. Because sometimes we can be doing things and there can be idols before God. I began to weep because I don't throw a pastor when God talked to me. I don't throw a pastor when I hear the word of God. Do you hear the saints of God? When God said you're wrong, guess what? I ask God for forgiveness and I repent from it. But let me show you something. Let me show you idol worship. A man is sitting there. The pastor take up tithes and offering. The man come and give $10. Before the service is over, God give the pastor something for that man. He said, you, come here. Thus says the Lord, you in business right now. And then he know the pastor don't know it. But the Spirit of God said that you've been struggling in your business. But God said from that day forward, God said it's going to prosper. Okay, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. God speak all these things. Guess what? The man get excited. The man go back and sit down, pull out his checkbook, and write a seed for $10,000 because you gave him the word. God said, that's idol worship. You said, how was that? Because God said at first, he wasn't going to give me $10,000. He just gave 10. God said his love for me was not that great. God said the only reason why he giving is because I gave him a word. Sometimes God will test your heart. God will test the prophet heart who's giving a word, and God will test the person heart who's getting a word. Give him the same God. He said he's not giving. Why come he didn't give $10,000 at first?
Come on.
Why did he have to wait before I gave him a word? God said, because he really loved me, he would have gave it $10,000 at first. And said, Father, I want your house to prosper. Yes. Did you understand, God? Yes. But God said, he only gave because he got a word.
Come on,
and sometimes we're using prophets as idols. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to give unless that prophet called and say something to me.
Come
you know
on.
Why? Because we're not giving for Jesus, we give it for a word.
Oh, yes.
And don't even know that we're in idol worship. And we stand before God. God gave millions into your house. God said, you didn't give it to me. God said you gave it so that your business can increase. God said you gave it so you can get more houses and get more clothes.
Yeah.
God said you gave it to be seen by men. But God said you didn't give it unto me. He said when you gave it, you didn't give it because Jesus don't love you. He said you gave it to get a word.
Oh, yes.
And since you gave it to give a word, that's all you got was a word.
All you got is a word.
But why not give it because God, I want more of you.
Oh,
why not do something for God? Because God, I want more of you.
Okay.
Why not sing unto God? Because God, I want more of you.
Yeah.
Come on, saints, God.
Yes.
Why not pray to God? Because God, I want more of you. And God said, most of the prayers that's coming up to heaven right now, he says it's about cars, it's about clothes, it's about give me a husband, give me a wife, give me a job. God's not against it, but God said every time they come before me in prayer, it's always something about them. He said they never come and say, God, I want more of you.
Yeah.
And God draw me closer to you. And God asked you to change me. And God, I want to walk in your holiness. And God, I want to be with you. And God, I can't make it without you. And God, change my heart. And God, heal me, oh God. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. But he said, their prayers is not because they love me. Come on, say to God. Because I'm not the only one that God's corrected. God's correcting a whole lot of people right now that's listening on YouTube. We don't love God. Let me tell you something. If you don't come in God's house down here, you ain't going to be in God's mansions up there. Because God said, if you don't come in my house on earth, he said, I'm not going to let you in my house on mansion because you don't want anything to do with me. Because I don't love you. Just tell the truth, saints of God. We don't love him. We don't seek him like that. I'm giving only because I want to get something from you, God. Not because you told me to. When are we going to get back to the place I'm doing it, God? Because you told me to. I'm serving the Lord because you told me to. I'm in prayer because you told me to. You told me to pray and not faint. You said, men, I've always prayed. When are we going to get back to the place where, God, I'm doing it? Because, God, you told me to. Not just to get something from you, God. But God said, who that seek me? He said, I'm going to be that sure reward. Let me tell you, you ain't going to see God. And God don't bless you. He that come to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who dare jealous seek him. If you seek God, God will take care of you. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things going to be added up to you. God said, you don't have to manipulate me and try to give me something to do something for you. God said, I love you. Be the same God. But he said, I want you to seek me.
Hallelujah.
Not just the things.
Yes, Jesus.
He said, because this church love. Minister of music, but I don't love God. You play on the keyboard, and then when the word get up, come up, you get up and leave out the door.
Come on, sir.
If the pastor don't pay you, you don't play.
Come on, sir.
You ain't doing it for Jesus, you doing it for money.
Come on.
And a person needs to call them out right now. You need to be called out right now. You ain't gonna preach. If they don't pay me, I'm not gonna preach. You need to be called out right now because you ain't doing it for Jesus. You doing it for money. You hear me, saints of God? We gotta be true to the house of God. Why are you doing it? Why are you prophesying? Why are you preaching? Why are you teaching? Why are you on the keyboard? Why are you on the drums? Why are you shouting around the church? Why are you directing the choir? Is it for Jesus or is it for you to get a record deal? Is it for money? Do you hear me, saints of God? Is it doing it for Jesus? Lord, forgive us.
Give us, Lord.
Forgive us, Lord.
Jesus.
This is the reason why the church is not ready for the return of Jesus. Because when he coming to a people who don't even want him. He coming to a people who ain't even ready for him. He coming to a people that's doing all these things, but they're not doing it for him. So Jesus hold himself back. He said, Father, let's don't go right now because my people are not ready. He said, my servants. He said, I'm not even speaking to my people. He said, apostles and the prophets and evangelists and the pastors and the teachers. They're not teaching my people. They're not preaching to my people. They're not warning my people. So Jesus got to wait. The mansions are ready, but the saints ain't ready. Heaven is ready, but the saints ain't ready. Do you hear the saints of God? But saints of God, we got to get ready. Everything that I do from the day forward, I'm doing it for Jesus. We don't have time for our job, but we don't have time for church. We'll be faithful to our job, but we won't be faithful to the house of God. You know why? Because we do not love you, Jesus. I come in anytime I get ready. You know why? We don't live our first love. Come on, saints of God. All we need to hear is just like this. We don't need to sugarcoat it, but we need the one word of God. Do you understand? Everybody, everything coming from Jesus, we can get a call. And I ain't going to church today because somebody called me and I need to see what they want. You love them more than you love Jesus. He said you love your mother, your father, your brother, your sister more than me. He said you are not worthy of me. He said you love them more than me. You are not worthy of me. He said you're not worthy even to follow me. You're not worthy to come into my presence. He said because you love them more than me. And every time we love anything or anybody more than God, it's idle. Nothing comes before God. But are we doing it for Jesus?
My God.
Or is that anointings can be an idol? A strong anointing. But why do you want this strong anointing? Is it just to operate in the anointing? Or is it because Jesus, I love you and I want your people to be saved?
Jesus.
Anointings can be idols. So strong anointing in this house. Yes. But do you love Jesus, the head of the house? We can't get trapped up in anointings and miracles and healings. And just because somebody get healed and miracles, you think all they from God. And you don't even know they love money more than they love God.
Come on, sir.
And let me tell you something to the ones who are always bossing in miracles and healings. Let me tell you something. When you get through healing somebody through the Spirit of God and you get through operating miracles, guess what? They still got to hear the word.
Yes, sir.
Because man don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded forth out of the mouth of God. I don't care if they get healed, they still got to hear the word of God. Yes. If the devil get cast out, they still got to hear the word of God. Yes. If miracles happen, they still got to hear the word of God. Yes. Getting healed ain't going to keep you. The word of God will keep you.
Yes, yes, Lord. Amen.
But we made idols, man. The anointing of God, an idol. The anointing is so strong in the house, but the anointing is an idol. You don't love Jesus, it's not the anointing. Big ministries is what we serve. God, give me a big ministry. I want 5,000 people, God. You're not trying to do what Jesus say. You want a big name for yourself.
Come on, sir.
Because your big name is your idol. Oh, thanks to God. God, allow me to hear this man of God. He said God gave him a vision. Say he seen a church, say it was packed. Say about 5,000 people was in there. He said, God told him, look closely. He said, the pastor at the altar was happy. He said, God said, look closely. He said, when you look closely, he said, God said nothing but two people in their mind. He said, the rest of them are not in their mind.
Oh, my God.
5,000 people in the house. And God said, don't know but two of them belong to me. Because they're not coming for me. They're coming to hear how to live a successful life. They coming to hear how to get rich. He said, they're not coming for me. And we think because the church is packed that everybody is saved. But Jesus said, straight and narrow is the way to eternal life. He said, the broad is the way to destruction. And Jerry Curry said, a lot of people don't need it. All of them is saved. But you see, straight and narrow, he said, that's the way to eternal life. I'm not seeing every church like that. I'm saying sometimes we get caught up in hype. Sometimes our ministers can be an idol. Sometimes our office can be an idol. It can be something that I worship pastor, I worship apostle, I worship our office. And when God says something to me, I don't do it. Why? Because I am the bishop.
Come on, sir.
And your office can't hide behind our office. I don't come in from pastor also. You have to say to God, they say you don't love me.
My God.
These things can be idols. And he said, listen, if you don't repent, he said, repent, change your mind. Stop what you're doing. He said, if you don't repent, I'm going to remove your lampstand. What do that mean, I'm going to remove your lampstand? He said, I'm going to shut down the church. He said, listen, the building might still be there, but the church is going to be gone. Because the church is not the building, the church is the people. He said, I'm going to shut it down. And when Jesus shut down a church, it's Ichabod, which means that the glory has departed. When Jesus shut down a church, it means there will be no more anointing flowing in the church. There'll be no more power flowing in the church. We got there right now in the house of God. We got people that God ain't up in there. Y'all just having a performance. It ain't nothing but a performance. Let's dress up and let's go to church. Let's have a big choir. But God is not in there. It's Ichabod, the glory of God. If already departed. And God said, if you don't repent, I'm going to pull back my power. I'm going to pull back my anointing. You're not going to merchandise the prophetic office anymore. You're not going to merchandise the anointing of God. I'm pulling back my presence. I'm pulling back my words. He said, I'm not going to let you feed my people anymore. Give him a sense of God. Because we're not doing it for Jesus. We're not doing it as unto the Lord. But we're doing it to ourselves. And he said, I'm going to move your lampstand. No more victory. No more Holy Ghost. No more gifts of the Spirit. No more fruit of the Spirit. No more breakthrough. No more salvation. Oh my God. And now since we don't got the power of God, we got to turn it into a fashion house. Now since we don't got the power of God, we got to turn it into a sideshow. Now since we don't got the power of God, we got to have all kind of performance. And let this preacher come in and preach. And let's get together and do this. And let's get ready to have a conference. And we having a revival. But you've been having a revival all year. We didn't tell you you had 18 revivals in 1 year. And ain't nobody changed. Ain't nobody delivered. You know why? Because it's Ichabod. The glory of God has departed. The power of God has departed. The presence of God has departed. Do you hear me say, God, we got to get back to Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
And we need to hear this word in the house of God. And God, I pray that you put leaders on it to hear this word, oh God. Because saints of God, if it's not the church, it's going to turn into a social club.
Come on.
It's going to turn into a place where women are walking back and forth with their heels on, throwing their hair to the side. Do you hear me, saints of God? Walking around with tight clothes on, with their cleavage showing. Tell us how God is good. Come on, saints of God. It's going to become a fashion show. People ain't going to come in and get healed. They're not going to come in and get delivered anymore. They're not going to come in and get the word. People are going to come in the church, and they're going to leave right back out. Because God ain't going to be speaking the word. But God says, you don't repent. If you don't get back to the right place, I'm going to snatch your lampstand. I'm going to move you out of place. You're not going to be a light of the world. your left hand.
My God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
He said you got something else going for you that I like. You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Uh-huh. And the Nicolaitans was people who said they were saints, but they indulged in wickedness. They lived wicked lives, slept around, and was at the temple shrines with prostitutes and all this kind of stuff. He said, I hate their deeds. He said, you hate it too. He said, but you just left your love, your first love. He said, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. And saints of God, this word that God is speaking, he said, listen, you will not receive it until you, first of all, have spiritual ears. But those of us who have spiritual ears, Father, we hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
We hear the sense, God, and I don't want to leave my first love. I've gotten away from some things, oh God, but I'm asking you to bring me back. I can't bring myself back, but I'm asking you to draw me by your Holy Spirit. God, put me back in the right place. God, help me do things for you. This can't be no sideshow. This can't be no one-time event. But it's got to be a lifestyle. Even if it says, God, anything that I put before you, oh God. Oh, my God. Thank you, Jesus. Screens, carry it over the screens. Thank you, Jesus. Run over there. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Anything, saints of God, that we have been put before God, and we know that we have left our first love. We have abandoned Jesus. And we're just going through the motions of church. And we're just being religious. It's not about our relationship with Jesus. But it's about us coming to church because our parents came to church. We got to step out of this religious mindset. The only reason why I'm giving, I'm just giving. But it's not out of love for Jesus. Come on, saints of God. We got to get back to our first love. We can't miss Jesus. We can't let Jesus come back. And we're not ready, saints of God. I don't want to stand before him. And he said, I'll never leave you. Depart from me. He said, you were preaching, but it wasn't for me. You were teaching, but it wasn't for me. You was giving, but it wasn't for me. You were prophesying, but it wasn't for me. But he said, it wasn't for me. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. You did things in my name. He said, but it wasn't for me. Come on, saints of God. We got to get back on the altar. We got to cry before God. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
No, Sunday.